subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Jaffrey with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. While Indian COVID trajectory is appearing promising in last 2 weeks, Prime Minister Narendra Modi wants citizens to be more cautious amid the festive season in the country. While addressing the nation in view of growing complacency among some sections of society, PM urged people to not put their guard down until a vaccine for COVID-19 was developed and distributed.
With single-day infections hovering around 55,000 against the average recovery of approximately 65,000 per day, India seemed to have gone past its peak period. The second most populous country, which recorded over 95,000 cases for several consecutive days in mid-September, India has successfully brought down its active case load to fewer than that of US and several other developed European countries in past 2 weeks. The testing has been vigorous and the positivity rate is one among the lowest in the world. However, Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who addressed the nation at the outset of a long festive season in the country, urged citizens to be responsible and not undo the progress India's sustained efforts have yielded in past few months.
त्योहारों के इस मौसम में बाजारों में भी रौनक धीरे-धीरे लौट रही है। लेकिन हमें ये भूलना नहीं है कि लॉकडाउन भले चला गया हो, वायरस नहीं गया है। बीते 7-8 महीनों में प्रत्येक भारतीय के प्रयास से भारत आज जिस संभली हुई स्थिति में है, हमें उसे बिगड़ने नहीं देना है।
India's national case fatality rate has come down to 1.51%, with state and federal governments aiming to further bring it down to 1%. Observers and experts say that these numbers can grow better if the coronavirus norms are properly followed and if people do not grow complacent on seeing a positive trend. Indian pharmaceutical companies that account for production of largest number of vaccines around the world are front and center at the race to supply effective vaccines to the world. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation says that world cannot be immunized without India. Government says that it has laid out a roadmap for the distribution of the vaccine whenever it is ready. Each single Indian will be vaccinated, PM said.
मानवता को बचाने के लिए युद्ध स्तर पर पूरी दुनिया में काम हो रहा है। अनेक देश इसके लिए काम कर रहे हैं। हमारे देश के वैज्ञानिक भी वैक्सीन के लिए जी जान से जुटे हैं। भारत में अभी कोरोना की कई वैक्सीन पर काम चल रहा है। इनमें कुछ एडवांस स्टेज पर है, आशास्पद स्थिति दिखती है। साथियों, कोरोना की वैक्सीन जब भी आएगी वो जल्द से जल्द प्रत्येक भारतीय तक कैसे पहुंचे, इसके लिए भी सरकार की तैयारी जारी है।
Meanwhile, the country has started showing green shoots after months of economic downturn owing to the pandemic. International Monetary Fund says the country's economy will rebound with a growth rate of around 8.8% in next fiscal year. While everyday shopping markets are yet to restore the pre-COVID energy and opulence, various other sectors are already on a swift recovery path. A steady rise in the stock market reflects the ground situation. New Delhi, meanwhile, has announced one more economic stimulus to boost the demand by $10 billion in coming months. The government says it is ready to take all measures to protect everybody who has been affected by the pandemic.
Moving on, Kashmiris across the world observed the Black Day on 22nd October. They shouted anti-Pakistan slogans while demanding freedom from its clutches. Pakistan has misruled the region for more than 73 years and has now ramped up its exploitative designs in collusion with China to further plunder it. It has used brute force to muzzle the voice of demand and dissent and is now working overtime to change the demography of the region so that it has free run with the projects it wants to install in the region.
Observing 22nd October as Black Day, people in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir took to streets and carried out a march against the occupier Pakistan. Carrying floats demanding freedom from the clutches of Islamabad, they sloganeered against the political masters of the country, who they accused of plunder and exploitation. Kashmiris observed the day as Black Day because it was on this day in 1947 when Pakistan's tribal militias attacked the region and gained control over its resources and affairs. Fearing his and his people's lives, the ruler of the then princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, Hari Singh, signed the instrument of accession with New Delhi on 26 October 1947, subsuming his entire territory into the sovereign nation of India. But Pakistan never vacated the place and has been illegally occupying thousands of kilometers of territory even today. It has even disregarded the United Nations in doing so. Kashmiris in POK, however, say that they will never accept Pakistan as their parent or home state and will continue their struggle until they ensure freedom. The anti-Pakistan anger is not just limited to the confines of Pakistan-controlled territories, but it has been simmering amongst Kashmiris living around the globe. from Washington to Tokyo to Malaysia to Nepal, a number of Kashmiri activists and their supporters observed the Black Day. They also highlighted the state-sponsored atrocities being committed by Pakistan in the region. Pakistan, they said, has been employing excessive force to muzzle the voice of demand and dissent. The press is censored so that the world doesn't get to know the reality. They also said that Islamabad has been working overtime to peddle lies on Kashmiri history, to change present narrative and to bring a favorable change in future through demographic alteration. However, Kashmiris are not buying any of its tricks and have called out its dubious designs both at home and at international platforms. Meanwhile, Kashmiris in India, who unlike Pakistani state, are equal and empowered citizens of the country, asked Pakistani PM and army generals to stay away from Kashmiri affairs.
मैं गुजारिश करूंगा इमरान खान साहब को और जनरल को कि प्लीज आप अपना ध्यान रखें जहां पे आपकी गवर्नमेंट चलाती है आर्मी और हमें आप तकलीफ दे रहे हैं आपको उसे क्या मिलेगा आप अपना ध्यान रखें हमें अपना काम करने दें हम अपने कार्य में हैं वी आर अ प्रोग्रेसिंग कंट्री सो वी रिक्वेस्ट यू इमरान खान साहब आप अपना अपने काम से मतलब रखें
Pakistani Prime Minister makes tall claims of working tirelessly for the welfare of Kashmiris. United Nations and other right groups, however, have termed its actions as human rights violations. Army generals who hold greater sway in the country's politics are the de facto administrators of the region. They have had no regards for the democratic functioning and have accorded a second-class citizen treatment to the people.
Moving on, an enormous public outcry following a brutal rape in Bangladesh has triggered a fresh debate on the safety of women in the country. While the government has pushed for a strong deterrence through death penalty for rapists, experts believe that a lot of other things are required to be assessed and altered to bring a real change in the society. A large number of women who gathered courage to come upfront post countrywide protests have unveiled a widespread culture of sexual exploitation at workplace in the country. Recently, hundreds of them demonstrated and urged authorities to bring changes into laws that they say didn't ensure a safe environment at their workplace.
Hundreds of protesters led by female garment workers took to streets in capital Dhaka, calling for a more friendly workplace and a new labor law that would protect women from sexual harassment and abuse at factories. Bangladesh, which ranks behind only China as a supplier of clothes to Western countries, relies on the garment industry for more than 80% of its exports and about 4 million jobs. Nearly 85% of the workers in these factories are women. But even then, due to an inherent discriminatory attitude against the women has hampered their safety in the factories.
আমরা আজকে এখানে আসছি বাংলাদেশের শ্রম আইনে যৌন হয়রানি নির্যাতন প্রতিরোধমূলক কোন আইনের আওতার মধ্যে ভুক্ত নাই সেই আইন নাই বলে আজকে কলকারখানায় বিভিন্ন জায়গায় শ্রমিকরা নির্যাতিত হচ্ছে এবং ধর্ষণ হচ্ছে
The government of Bangladesh had introduced labor laws for the country in 2006 but critics say that it has failed in addressing gender based violence including sexual harassment at the workplace. A nationwide study in 2018 had said that 85% of female garment workers face verbal abuse, 71% faces mental torture, 21% face physical torture, and 13% face sexual abuse. According to report in US Senate committee, while the factory safety had improved relatively since the Rana Plaza disaster of 2013, Bangladesh was backsliding on the workers' rights. The Senate committee had urged authorities to do more to protect the labor rights, but things haven't changed much on the ground.
নতুন করে নতুন আইন নতুন বিধি সংশোধন করুক এটাই আমাদের প্রত্যাশা কারণ আজকে দেখা যাচ্ছে শ্রমবান্ধব নারীবান্ধব কর্মপরিবেশ এবং আইন না থাকাতে নারী এবং বিশেষ করে শ্রমজীবী নারী এবং শ্রমিকরা পদে পদে বঞ্চিত হচ্ছে এখন বর্তমানে যে রুলস তৈরি হচ্ছে বা সংসদে যাবে সেটা শ্রমিকদের পক্ষেই না সেটা শ্রমিকদের বিপক্ষে তাই আমরা বলতেছি শ্রমিকবান্ধব আইন এবং শ্রমিকবান্ধব রুলস সংশোধন করুন
The number of females contributing to labor force of the country rose to nearly 16% in 1996 to over 36% in 2017. But even this trend hasn't been able to deter criminals. Some say it is not just one crime but women in Bangladesh are subject to a number of discrimination and indoor crime, many of which are not even reported in the media and even fewer reach the courts. Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina's government has taken a host of measures and floated a number of policies to empower women, and it has helped grow a number of them in recent, but that hasn't been able to curb the rate of crime against women.
Moving on, India's proactive diplomacy combined with assertive decision-making while dealing with China seems to have rattled the Beijing leadership. The signs of nervousness in Beijing corridors are prominent. While India's war preparedness and growing Quad cooperation had already pushed an otherwise belligerent China on back foot, Indian media seems to be giving it sleepless nights now. Reason? An independent, vibrant media has been showing the truth, China dearly protected from the world. Today in South Asia Focus, we will show you how China has shifted its goalpost from aggressively transgressing into others' territory to desperately saving its own face at multiple fronts.
These tweets by spokesman of Chinese embassy to India have two underlying messages. One, China doesn't want the issue of territories under its occupation to go global. Two, it is not enjoying the taste of its own medicine. After copy editing, proofreading, and subjecting each single news item to censorship scrutiny in its mainland, the Communist China now wants to control what free media in other countries speaks about it. Maybe it is alien to the fact that the media in democracies like India doesn't operate at whims and fancies of state, but its own acumen and objectivity. Truth is the cornerstone of a news story and not what president pleases to see with his morning beverage. China has been rattled by Indian moves, both diplomatic and military, and now it doesn't know how to react in a situation that has been complexed by its own strategists and leaders. India, which has ramped up its war preparations, says it still wants a peaceful resolution.
India and China have continued to have discussions through both diplomatic and military channels to peacefully resolve the issues along the LAC in the India-China border areas. This is in keeping with the agreement reached between the two foreign ministers during their meeting in Moscow on the 10th of September 2020. The immediate task is to ensure a comprehensive disengagement of troops in all the friction areas.
While India seeks a peaceful solution, it is not ready to give in at any front against China. In fact, it has doubled down on its war preparations. As many as 12 missile tests have been conducted by India in just 30 days. This year's Malabar exercise has already received participation nod from all Quad countries. New Delhi is also set to sign some strategic deals with US in coming days. rapid infrastructure development is giving it more troubles. And now, a corner China is showing some signs of giving up on its devious agenda.
The two sides have reiterated their desire to maintain dialogue and communication through military and diplomatic channels and arrive at a mutually acceptable solution for disengagement as early as possible. We continue to remain engaged with the Chinese side, and we will let you know when there is further information to share.
Today, China is running out of options. While it has already received bad press for the pandemic, its land grab tricks have been opposed and retaliated. The regions it has illegally occupied for years have received global support in past few months. Smaller states like Vietnam have confronted its bully tricks. Its dead diplomacy has been exposed, and the country is making more enemies than allies. There are reports of implosions within the top communist leadership. President Xi is faced with colossal opposition, and now its aggression has converted into a desperate face-saving exercise.
A melting pot of various religious and cultural backgrounds, India celebrates the true spirit of life through several festivals throughout the year. Though celebrated in different ways, almost all the festivals mark the victory of good over evil. One among them is the Dussehra that commemorates Lord Ram defeating the demon king Ravan. In some parts of India, especially in northern states, a centuries-old series of mythological play based on the life of Lord Ram, known as Ramlila, is performed. The much-awaited play, which till date has managed to capture the imaginations of both young and old alike, is the quintessential element of Navratri and the Dussehra festivals. Have a look.
Donned in colourful traditional costumes, the actors are playing the characters of the great Hindu epic Ramayana in a theatrical manner called Ramlila. Performed during the annual nine-night Navratri festival, Ramlila tells the journey and teachings of Hindu Lord Ram, including his childhood, annihilation of forest demons, his marriage with Mithila princess Sita, her abduction by demon king Ravan, and the subsequent war to free her and kill Ravan. The story is narrated in a typical style with devotional songs and dances performed on the tunes of popular Bollywood numbers. Every year, thousands of people across the country watch the play, which is performed in almost all the cities in India with much adoration and fervor. However, this year, with the restrictions on gathering in place, the repertoires in various cities have decided to broadcast the play online.
जब प्रभु श्री राम का मंदिर का भव्य निर्माण हो रहा है उसी दौरान ये कार्य करने का अवसर मुझे प्राप्त हो रहा है तो ये बहुत ही बड़े सौभाग्य की बात है और मैं चाहूँगा कि प्रभु श्री राम का आशीर्वाद भोले बाबा का आशीर्वाद सभी पर हो सभी पर प्रभु अपनी कृपा दृष्टि बनाए रखे
Similar scenes were witnessed in the city of Nawabs, Lucknow, where actors have played different characters from Ramayana and performed inside a temple and broadcasted the show online due to the coronavirus pandemic. Characters dressed to suit the perfect role play, with Hanuman and the evil characters to providing all the delight to the kids. The play also propagates the ideal way of living, and the Hindu devotees consider Lord Ram and Goddess Sita as the epitome of perfection. the final day of Ram Leela, or 10th, is the burning effigy of egoistic Ravan along with his brother Kumbhakaran and his son Meghnad. It is followed by the grand fireworks at the place.
Devotees say Ram Leela is the best screenplay ever written. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.